coming and being a part of the first social distancing house concert. And just so happy and excited that you're here tonight, because I love playing music, and a lot of gigs have been canceled, and that's hard, you know. So I want to play some music for you tonight, and this is kind of, I spend a lot of my time playing music, and people sometimes wonder, well, how do you spend your time now that you're not working as a doctor? And you know, I basically spend my time tuning instruments. So as you can see, I have quite a few here tonight. So let me know if the sound isn't to your liking, or I should play less or talk less, and just put a comment in, and my dear wife Deborah will signal me and give me all kinds of things. Okay, can you guys hear me all right so far? Is anybody out there? I'm going to start out with a song called Planks de Fluharty that I wrote in 1994. I can hear claps telepathically, and thank you very much. It's weird playing to just my wife, though. That's often my main audience, and she helps me to write some songs and tells you when it's a thumbs up or down. So this is a hammered dulcimer, and it's got a lot of strings, and there was a time in my career when I thought that I would make a living building dulcimers, so this isn't one of them, but I built about four of them, and turns out that after I figured out how many hours I put into it, I was making about $1.80 an hour. So I ended up thinking that probably wasn't a good idea. Another idea I had recently was about a 24-hour mobile harmonica repair service. And I thought, holy smokes, I hope nobody else has thought of this, because what a boon. Could you imagine me going to a bank and asking for a small business loan and kind of saying to them, hey, you know, I need about maybe $25,000 start, because I need a van, because there's, you know, I got outfitted for all these things. And I think that, and the guy with the banker would say, so what are you going to do with that $20,000 or whatever? And I'd say, well, I'm going to have a 24-hour mobile harmonica repair service. And I'm sure that they would give me that loan right away, of course. But anyway, I didn't think about that too often for too long, but it does seem like it's a viable option. If you want to lose $20,000 real fast. This next instrument is something called a corded zither, or an auto harp. It's a very special and beautiful one that a friend of mine named Bob Taylor made. And
Elaine asks, I didn't know the harmonica could be repaired.
Oh, yes. The harmonica can definitely be repaired, believe it or not. And there's a skill to it, and a highly paid skill. You could retune it and change the combs out. And just think about all the times those blues players in the middle of the gig, their harmonica goes bad on them, and they do go bad, and they're expensive, you know. So rather than having to buy a new one, you know, you just call up the mobile harmonica repair service, and you know, I'll get there in 3 days down to Memphis if you just hold on. So anyway, that's something I think about in my spare time. Maybe I have too much time on my hands. So this is built by Robert Taylor, who's a company he had called Clapping Trees Instruments, and he built these beautiful auto harps back in the 80s and early 90s, and he gave me one, which was such a gift. And this is just one of the most beautiful instruments, and when people hear it, they usually, when I'm playing, you know, background music, this is the one thing where they usually stop talking for a few minutes to listen to it. So thank you, Bob, for building this for me. And
Bob and Sue are on, by the way.
Oh, good, good. So thank you, Bob and Sue, for encouraging my music. Sweetest instruments I've ever played and heard. And thanks, Bob Taylor and Sue Taylor, for Clapping Trees Instruments. These are beautiful maple back and spruce top, and I think it's rosewood on the chord bars, and just a beautiful instrument. And he gave that to me, so I'm very blessed in my life to have friends like that. I have so many instruments and so little time, but I'm going to do what I can. I won't talk too much, and unless you have some good questions or some questions that you're just dying to ask.
People are giving applause.
Thank you so much.
You have a lot of nice friends on here.
Thank you, folks.
I'm sorry, I can't say all their names. I'm afraid I'll shut off the video
if I do too much.
But thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Here.
Appreciate it. Is the sound okay? Can you hear the sound? Can you hear me talking?
They said Dan Fresney says, I hope you or someone is recording this.
I think it'll be Dan. I think it'll be on Facebook. That's Dan from up in Connecticut, my French-Canadian friend, Dan. He has a band too called Lugnaut, if you're ever up in the Connecticut area, to check him out. I think it'll be recorded when I get done. If I don't hit the wrong button, it'll be archived to Facebook, so hopefully.
Benjamin Rentler says thumbs up on the sound.
Oh, good. You could hear it from Japan. Boy, that's pretty good, that, these interwebs. You know, my son in Japan could even hear it. Thanks, Benji. This here is a instrument called a dobro. It's been probably around 1930 they designed it to try to compete with orchestras by putting this big, loud resonator in it. And it became very popular in Hawaiian music, and it also became very popular in country music. And my favorite kind of music, or one of my favorite kind of music, is the blues. So here we go, a little song called Maggie's Blues. And this is a song about my late dog Maggie, a little Shih Tzu, who went on to better places. But we used to lock her in the crate so that she would learn how to control her bodily functions. And I used to wonder what she was thinking while she was in the crate. So this is a song about that. It's the only folk song I know in the history of folk music that uses the word anthropomorphism. And you could look that up, but I think it might be true. I said, throw me a bone, I got too much time on my hands. I said, throw me a bone, I got way too much time on my hands. You locked me up in this crate all day. I fulfill your demand. Life has never lived with me. Locked up in this crate all day is a tragic destiny. I said, throw me a bone, I got way too much time in my hand. You locked me up in this crate all day till I fulfill your demand. Well, this brown food you're feeding me is called the science diet. If it really tastes so good, why don't the scientists try it? I said, throw me a bone, I got way too much time in my hand. You know, I've been this crate all day, till I feel you to the man. Well, if dogs could get depression, I'd be the first to know. If they made puppy Prozac, I'd take an overdose. Well, throw me a bone, I got way too much time in my hand. This crate all day. You're teaching me, you're starting to make me yawn. All I want to do is empty my bladder on the lawn. Well, throw me a bone, I got way too much time in my hand. You lock me up in this crate all day till I fulfill your demand. If I could reach a telephone, I'd tell you what I'd do. I'd call up the ASPCA and I'd tell them all about you. Well, throw me a bone, I got way too much time in my hand. Lock me up in this crate all day till I feel your demand. There's Maggie's Blues. I'm going to do another song for you guys. I'm going to play guitar now. And this is a very special guitar. It's a Martin guitar. I have a lot of friends in the factory and I've wanted one my whole life. And finally, when I was 35 years old, I was able to finally afford to get one. And this is one that my late wife had bought for me. So first Martin I ever played was this little Martin guitar that somebody named Stacy, who might be watching tonight, she had one in high school. I couldn't believe it. How could somebody have a Martin guitar in high school? And she let me play it even, so that was pretty cool. So the song goes out to Stacy and that little Martin she had. It was like a 000 something. It was really small and cute, and it was a Martin, you know. So I went to medical school just so I could afford to get one, but not as long. Just kidding. So there's a little song called Footsteps. And this is played in a Martin D41, which is beautiful Indian rosewood. And for all you guitar folks out there, it's got a really nice high-grade, I think it's Adirondack spruce top, I'm not sure. But anyway, it was a great gift. Next song I do, I hope you guys are doing okay. I'm kind of, these are tough times, and I hope and pray everybody's doing okay. And these are just tough times, you know. There's just so I'm gonna provide some levity hopefully tonight, and so I'm doing all my happy stuff tonight for the most part. I hope that's okay. So this is a song, so it's a true story about the first new car I ever got. It was in 1994, and it was a Ford a Ford Taurus, and I just kind of bought it because I needed a car really fast because my other car got in an accident. And so anyway, when I drove it out of the car dealer, I spilled coffee all over the seat, and so I didn't have the new car smell very much. So this song's called New Car Smell. It was played on NPR as bumper music back, I think, in 2006 or 7. So here's New Car Smell. When I got my new car and I drove it off a lot, spilled my cup of coffee and it was steaming hot. The aroma of the coffee beans and the cream as it did rot made me suddenly realize that my new car smell was shot. I like to eat my breakfast when I'm on the run. Banana peels and hard-boiled eggs, oh, they're so much fun. I like to toss the apple cores and empty yogurt cups over my left shoulder, cause I think it brings me luck. That new car smell has never been much to me. Never even been a possibility. The aroma of this sweet old earth is more my cup of tea. Got a compost pile growing underneath my seat. My wife, she won't drive with me unless the windows all roll down. My neighbors hold their noses as we drive it into town. We don't need the heat on because we're warmed organically. Got a compost pile growing underneath my seat. My son, he wanted to borrow my car to go out on a date. I told him to use protection, those gas masks are great. He told me not to worry, cause his girlfriend would understand. Cause she was the daughter of the Roto-Rooter man. That new car smell has never been much to me. Never even been a possibility. The aroma of this sweet old earth is for my cup of tea. Got a compost pile growing underneath my seat. Once I was pulled over by an Orfield traffic cop. When I rolled my window down, his countenance did drop. I knew I was in trouble, but I didn't know what to say. He called in reinforcements from the EPA. Well, sometimes I do wonder if I'm a hazard on the road. One more rotten sandwich and I know she can explode. While we're worried about those weapons far across the deep blue sea. Got a compost pile growing underneath my seat. That new car smell has never been much to me. Never even been a possibility. The aroma of this sweet old earth is more my cup of tea. Got a compost pile growing underneath my seat. Got a compost pile growing underneath my seat. Thank you very much. Thank you. And that's just a nice, beautiful Martin guitar from my friends up at Martin. Speaking of Martin, this is a Martin ukulele, a tenor ukulele. Tenor is one of the largest ones. The largest is a baritone, and this is the third or the second largest, I guess. And it's made of beautiful kowood, which is only found in Hawaii. And it's a very precious wood, and they don't cut the trees down. They wait till they fall down before they harvest it. So it's pretty rare, and one of these days could be very rare. So anyway, my friends up there, Brendan and his friends picked me the, they told me, really sweet, mapley, flamey-looking koa piece. So I really appreciate that. And it's got a just a beautiful sound. This little instrumental I wrote called Claire. It's a ode to my other little Shih Tzu who went to doggy heaven, so. Thank you. medical question, Sean.
Sean asks, Russ, your happy tunes are the exact prescription for troubling times. I know you have specific experience for dealing with medical disasters. Do you have any specific general advice for everyone who is having to pause and shelter at home?
Any advice? Other than what you're hearing on TV, be safe, be careful, be prayerful. You know, when I go out, I bring a little bottle of alcohol and a paper towel, and I wipe the cart when I go shopping. And I was in Guitar Center today because I broke a mandolin string. And before I went in there, I know I look like a nut, but I, you know, put alcohol on. I use the alcohol and the paper towel to open the door and close it. And, you know, I got to do it because I'm high risk my age. And, yeah, I know I look good for my age, but I'm old, you know. And so, you know, I think that for you guys, the best thing to do is not panic, but just make good decisions. And, you know, what we used to do in the nursing home, we had a flu every year come around. And basically what we try to do is isolate the best we can, is, you know, just literally keep the visitors off the floors. And I think in the same sense as if we limit our travel, and that's probably going to be the best thing that we could do. And, you know, the usual hand washing, and you know, us wearing a mask doesn't really help unless you're sick. The virus particles will just go all around that. So that's kind of, don't panic if you don't have a mask. But I would definitely not be in close quarters with people. I'd stay away from elevators. And you know, even our parish just gave the bishop just gave a dispensation, so to speak, so that you don't have to go to mass if you don't choose to, if you're worried about it. And, you know, I've been thinking about that, because, you know, a lot of times you go, and, you know, you go to church and people are coughing all over the place. So anyway, it's probably better to be safe than sorry, and, you know, the Lord knows. So that's all I can say about that. I'm trying to watch the news too much because they're hyping everything up, but you know,
they want the volume louder.
Turn up the volume. Okay, all I could do is talk a little louder. I have a stereo microphone that unfortunately attenuates the volume a little bit. But this here is my grandmother's ukulele, and it's a very special ukulele. It's over 110 years old. It's a Martin. You can see it on the very back there. It says Martin there. But it's made of, I believe this is made of mahogany, and it's just a sweet little, now this is what's called a soprano, which is the smallest ones. And they're just paper thin, and this is so light. So I never usually bring this to gigs with me. So you folks who are watching are getting a special treat, because I almost never bring this out because I'm so nervous about it. So this is my grandma's uke, and this little song I wrote for our little instrumental called Grandma's Uke. A little tune called Grandma's Uke, and I'm going to get back to some of those. This here next instrument I'm doing, this is called an octave, or I'm sorry, it's a mandola, and it's a little bit bigger than a mandolin, and it's tuned C, and this is a G, This is a D, and this is an A. So it's tuned a lot differently, a lot lower, and it's, you kind of sing a little bit with it. This little instrumental I wrote called, and this particular instrument for you guitar folks, are, it's made out in Montana. It's a Weber. Bruce Weber signed it, and I bought it used, as I buy most of my stuff. Got a good deal. There's a song called Storm Over Delmarva that I wrote. Mandolin now, and so many instruments, so little time. I was going to do 30 minutes. I have about 10 minutes. I'm going to think about, could I do maybe 40 minutes? Would that be okay with you guys? How does that sound? Is there a consensus that I should just shut up and play? And but this is mandolin. This is 107 years old. It's a Gibson F2 mandolin that I've wanted my whole life, and recently was able to sell a bunch of instruments to get this. Instruments that I wasn't using. And just a beautiful instrument. This is a song called Jesus Loves His Mandolin Player, number 35, written by Frank Wakefield. And I've been trying to play this since high school. Do another quick song. This is by John Hartford, and I learned this one in high school. Thank you. beautiful, beautiful F5, oh, sorry, F2 mandolin, and made in 1913, believe it or not. And I don't know what to play next. I have so many instruments and so little time. I'm going to do a little song that, this is a true story, and as all my songs are, it's a song about, well, it's a love song that I wrote for my wife about our teardrop trailer that I built for her. And the teardrop trailer is this kind of retro trailer. They were very popular in the 30s. And when the highway system got built, people started building their own little trailer. So looks like a little kind of rounded thing. You open up the back and you can make coffee and stuff in there. It's called the galley. So I wrote a little song because Deborah and I went across the country. The first thing I did when I retired, I started building this thing before I retired in the hopes of, it was kind of what kept me going to get to the finish line, knowing that someday I'd be able to actually have time to travel a little bit. So we went to California, and it took about 10 weeks to get there and back. And on the way back, my wife said, you know, I think we could use a bigger trailer. So I built another one. It's a little bigger. But I can't give up this teardrop because of the song. It's called No Tears in My Teardrop. Sometimes this whole world can bring me down, and it's easy for me to get the blues. Nothing in this world can turn me round like thinking of my teardrop with you. There'll be no tears in my teardrop as long as I'm camping with you. There'll be no tears in my teardrop, and my campfire will always burn for you. That I built. This is another corded zither or an auto harp, and I built this after being inspired by my good friend Bob Taylor and his harp. So this is, to be honest with you, it doesn't shine a light to his harp, but I got in my skin to build instruments, and I think he always inspired me. And even though I was in college and med school and then in a busy practice, I always wanted to build instruments. And so I finished this as soon as I got done as soon as I retired. They've been waiting unfinished in my basement for a long time. This is a song called The Flowers of Edinburgh. Much. This is the auto harp is definitely one of my favorite instruments. Got a few requests for some vocal songs, but I still got some instrumentals I want to try. That's okay with you. It's 8:12. I'll try to get this over by 8:30. Is that okay? That'll be about an hour. It's longer than I planned, and I apologize. One thing I did want to mention to you folks is that since you've all been kind enough to tune in, I have a couple CDs for a giveaway, and the way this is going to go is that whoever can send me, you go to my website, russrentler.com, it's pretty easy, R-U-S-S-R-E-N-T-L-E-R, Russ Rentler, just Google my name, and it goes to my website, and there's a contact there, and I won't spam you or anything. If you want to sign up for the mailing list, that's fine, but you don't have to, you just contact me and tell me how many strings are on all these instruments, and the two people who have the closest estimate of these strings is going to get a free CD, and you go to my website and you could tell me which one you want. I have about four or five different CDs, and this one's Scarecrow's Lament, which maybe I'll get to, Tom. So anyway, if you can count up all these instruments and estimate how many strings. Now remember, the mandolin has eight, not four, because they're unison, so that's all I'm going to say about that. And the hammer dulcimer has a bunch, and it's at least 100 or more. So the first two people who get the top closest numbers will get free CDs. I'll ship them to you. Just send me your the number that you think it is, and send me your address, and I'll let you know if you win.
Benjamin Rentler asked, do you even know the answer to that?
I don't, but I'm going to look it up. Wise guy, Ben. No, I'm going to count all the I'm going to count up all the instruments after the gig, and that's how I'll figure it out. You know, what's interesting about playing for you folks is I got as excited setting up to play for you as I do playing for a live gig, meaning the same amount of energy and nervousness that I generate. Believe it or not, I got that way, which is good, I think. I just appreciate people that want to listen to my music, and it's kind of an ego thing, I guess, but I do appreciate it so much. It's a gift of time that you've given to me, and I appreciate that. I'm not a very good fiddler. I've been fiddling, well, my whole life, but since I retired, I've been trying to play the violin a little bit, and same thing as a fiddle. So I'm going to try this. This is kind of an experiment, and this was requested. Baker for Cassie. So, and I'm gonna do a little banjo for you. That's okay. I don't know what you could do. It's not okay, but I'll try to. I appreciate you guys being here. I really do. So this is a song I wrote called Passins Creek. It's on my album called Escape the Tide. This is a little story I wrote, a little kind of fake love story. It's what I think has all the elements of the classic American short story. It's about love, deception, and moonshine. So once a week, skin's fair and eyes so blue, I think about her all the time. Pretty little girl on Hassan's Creek, I'm gonna make her mine. But I can't touch. He makes moonshine up on the hill, and he thinks that no one knows. His secret will be safe with me if he lets his daughter go. Forever sealed about the moonshine on his land. I just want to tell you real quick about this banjo. I got it when I was on vacation last year, and it's a Bart Ryder, and Bart is from Michigan. He makes some of the best banjos in the world, and look at that inlay work there. It's just what a master craftsman Bart is, and thank you, Bart. I got it used, but I guess in the long run it hopefully benefits him, and I didn't get to purchase it from him directly, but anyway, this is, I actually sold some banjos because this meant so much to me. Once I got this one, I thought, well, that's about it. I'm going to do a little song that I think I first wrote this song in, when I was 15 years old. And this is a dulcimer. And this dulcimer here is a mountain dulcimer or a lap dulcimer, an Appalachian mountain dulcimer. And I built this one this summer when I had just a burst of energy. My good neighbor George gave me this beautiful cedar, and I had some, and maybe gave me some walnut too, and I found this beautiful piece of striped maple, and so I built this. This is a baritone, which is a little bigger than the standard mountain dulcimer, and the sound holes are kind of, these are like F holes like a violin, and these holes are either chromosomes or this 19th or this device we used in the old century ago. It was called the telephone for some of you young folks. Telephone was something you used to communicate with people, but these little sound holes look like telephones or chromosomes, I don't know which. So this song is called No Stopping or Standing, and I got the words from street signs as I was riding in the back seat of my friend's car. He had a left-handed mandolin because he liked Jimi Hendrix, so I had to figure out how to play his left-handed mandolin. I came up with this song and never recorded it until 2017. It's just one of those things that banged around in my head, and I thought, oh, well, it's a silly song like most of my songs, and that's sometimes a good thing. No stopping or standing on this road. Miles per hour on this road. I've been on this road for so many miles. I've been on this road for so many hours. No stopping or standing on this road. Checked by radar on this road, and the bridge freezes before the pavement on this road. I've been on this road for so many miles. I've been on this road for so many hours. No stopping or standing on this road. Highway tax dollars are at work on this road. Jimmy Hoffa's body's not buried under this road. And there's no stopping or standing on this road. I've been on this road for so many miles. I've been on this road for so many hours. No stopping or standing on this road. I've been drinking too much coffee on this road. And there are no bathrooms on this road. And if we don't stop soon, my bladder's gonna explode. There's no stopping or standing on this road. I've been on this road for so many miles. I've been on this road for so many hours. No stopping or standing on this road. Thank you so much. That's a little dulcimer tune. I'm gonna play. Let's see. I'm gonna do two more songs, and I'll let you guys go. I think I've played every instrument here, and I'm gonna. Is there any? Well, there are two requests. Somebody wants me to do. Somebody asked me to do a song called the.
Michelle said, give him some water so he can keep playing.
Give me some water. I think I need more than water, Michelle. But yeah, I got some water. Thank you. You think water will keep me going?
Michelle Keeler.
Yeah.
Is she a nurse?
Yeah, Michelle's a nurse. She's a good nurse. She's one of my first contacts at Lehigh Center. Michelle was there. She used to make rounds with me. It was really nice. So, about 2002, they said that the prairie dogs in the Lehigh Valley were disappearing, and we had this zoo up here and called the Trexler Zoo, and suddenly they noticed that 35 prairie dogs had disappeared. And so I got to thinking about that, and it was also the time they said there was a malpractice crisis in Pennsylvania where the cost of malpractice was going up so that the doctors were all fleeing the state, they said. Kind of turns out that it really wasn't true, which is kind of frustrating. But anyway, long and short is, this is a little song about prairie dogs. So maybe it's about doctors and lawyers and insurance too. I don't know. We'll see. See what you think. I hope I can remember the words. So if I can't, who's ever out there, if you can give me some of the words as we go along. Those prairie dogs of Lehigh have all left town. Environment got too hostile. They're seeking higher ground. Some say they went to Ohio, others to the Adirondacks. This one went to Emmaus, and he's not coming back. The ostrich and the zookeepers had their heads in the sand. They didn't seem to notice those elaborate departure plans. The insomniac buffaloes bid farewell as they headed out the bluff. They bought a one-way ticket for that prairie dog exodus. The peacock, she all got flustered. There was nothing she could do. Wise owl, he didn't know anything. He could barely give a hoot. I'm losing the words. Sorry, guys. They bought a one-way ticket for that prairie dog exodus. It's been a while. Those prairie dogs of Lehigh have all gone away. Everyone points the finger, but no one takes the blame. Sorry, guys. Think they'll be coming back from that prairie dog exodus. Wow, I'm gonna work on that, folks. Sorry about that. I apologize. I haven't played it in a while, so I forgot some of the words. I'm very sorry about that. The idea was they got on a Beaver bus and they took off, and there was a line in there about them. Somebody said, "What are they doing? They're playing miniature golf down at Quakertown." And so I apologize. I do a little song that's a true story about my Grammy, and I think I'll remember the words to this song. This is a true story about my grandmother, who sadly lost her eye when she was a young girl. She had a violin, and the string broke, and it hit her in the eye and blinded her, and it was very disfiguring. It kind of made her cornea opacify. So I don't know if you've ever seen Marilyn Manson, kind of crazy metallic rocker, but my grandma kind of looked like Marilyn Manson. When she came over, it was a little scary. You know, I'm a little kid, and this, you know, and she kind of became a bitter soul, unfortunately, and became kind of a chronic alcoholic. But the weird thing is she, as much as she smoked and drank, she loved to read Prevention magazine. And I have a dry cough. I hope I don't have a fever. I hope you all have a viral antivirus software. Excuse me. I know I'm going to live before I get done with this, so don't worry. Don't worry. So this is a song about my one-eyed grandma, and you all can sing along. And it's a true story. Every time I do it, I think about my friend Tim. He said, "Russ, every time I see you do it differently." And that's true, Tim. And tonight I'm probably going to do it differently again. drink rye. When she comes over to visit, I look for a place to hide. When she was a little girl, she played the violin. One day a string broke and did her eye in. So she put down the fiddle and she picked up a bottle of rye. Now I got a one-eyed grandma, and you know we don't see eye to eye. I got a one-eyed grandma, and you know she loves to drink rye. When she comes over to visit, I look for a place to hide. Oh, grandma used to tell me that sugar was my death. Hey, grandma, can I light you up another cigarette? It's amazing to me that she lived to be 85. When she spent most of her lifetime completely anesthetized. Oh, grandma used to tell me I was a Capricorn. She said I'd have bad luck from the day that I was born. Well, I thank my grandma for building my self-esteem. Well, if it wasn't for Jesus, my best friend would be Jim Beam. Over to visit, I look for a place to hide. Who likes your cheap whiskey? Well, grandma and my mama both love the fruit of the vine. And when they get together, those sparks are gonna fly. Oh, I know this story's been sad and I'm not too proud, but there's a silver lining to this hereditary cloud. 'Cause I thank my grandma for giving me this musical gene. And that three-string violin that she left me. Thank you very much. It's kind of a silly song. You guys have been great. I really appreciate it. I'm going to do one more song for you, and I'm going to say goodnight. God bless you guys. And again, if you could send me an email to russrentler.com and tell me how many strings you think are here, you could win. There'll be two people who are going to get CDs. And do people listen to CDs anymore? I don't know. I hope so. This is a true story, and it's called Scarecrow's Lament. Several people had requested it. It's on my album called Scarecrow's Lament. And it's about Dorothy and the Scarecrow and how they kind of fell in love during the making of the movie The Wizard of Oz. A lot of people don't realize that. And I discovered that after, it was around 3 in the morning, I'd been drinking all night long, drinking large quantities of coffee all night long. And I was, you know, starting to get into that fourth zone, you know, after about your third pot of coffee where you're feeling a little jazzed, you know, and you're starting to see things that other people don't see after that much coffee, you know. So it was about 3 in the morning. I'm watching Wizard of Oz, but I like to watch it in reverse. I don't know why. It's just a thing about me. But if you put the DVD and you put it in reverse, there's a scene on Yellow Brick Road where I realize that Dorothy and the Scarecrow's eyes, they just meet. Do you know what I'm saying? Like that. Just like that. And you knew in that second that they had something going there. But, you know, the Scarecrow, heck, he was, you know, 35, she was 15. So, in some states, that's, you know, illegal. So, anyway, I took that concept in this song and I placed it in the 1970s when I was coming of age. And so it's called Scarecrow's Lament. And you guys have been great. Thank you. Nobody coughed on me the entire time, which I really appreciate.
You coughed on me, though.
I coughed on Debbie. I feel bad. And my battery's going to die, so here we go. Can't recharge because the mic is there. Hope I get done with the song before my battery dies. If not, good night. Darling, the Scarecrow were star-crossed lovers. They stepped out of their roles one moonless night. They borrowed Dorothy's uncle's old Camaro, and they drove it right across the Kansas line. They're about an hour outside of Tulsa, missing day tracks and driving way too fast. Proud Mary, she never sounded better. They could barely hear the trooper's siren blast. Where are you when I need you? We're in a storm of trouble now, and these old red slippers must have lost their magic. Maybe you can send a couple foul. The officer was a little less than cordial, but Dorothy charmed him with her ruby Ritz. She got to ride shotgun back to Kansas, while the Scarecrow, he got handcuffed to the fence. The hanging judge, he threw the book at Scarecrow. 15 will get you 20, you should be ashamed. Could have saved yourself a lot of trouble, Mr. Scarecrow, if you only had a brain. Oh, Annie Ann, where are you when I need you? Slippers must have lost their magic. Maybe you can send a couple foul. Now Dorothy's back in Kansas doing homework. Scarecrow's in the slammer doing time. Some days seem longer than others, but he can't get Dorothy off his mind. Some days he dreams of flying monkeys, some nights he fears he's gone insane. He's studying to be a malpractice lawyer. It's amazing what you can do without a brain. Oh, Annie M, where are you when I need you? We're in a storm of trouble now, and these old red slippers must have lost their magic. Maybe you can send a little foul. Oh, Annie M, where are you when I need you? We're in a storm of trouble now, and click my heels together just ain't working. And send a couple foul. Well, thank you so much, guys, for listening. I really had a lot of fun tonight. I hope you did. And stay safe, be careful, be prayerful, and let's all keep in mind in our thoughts and prayers for all the people who are suffering under this the virus and just the panic, and everybody in China and just across the world, and just everybody will just keep praying and we'll get through this. And thank you so much, and God bless you. And guess how many strings I have, and you could win a CD. Go to my website, Russ Rentler, contact me, tell me how many strings you think I have up here tonight. And thanks again for your time. I really so much appreciate it. Take care. God bless.